Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Largo Tampa Bay Christadelphian Ecclesia. We're going to open our service up this week by singing together, by praising God together with hymn 88. Afterwards, we'll have our opening prayer. Hymn 88. By the way, all the hymns today come from our reading in James chapter 1. Hymn 88. Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not. Thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Hymn 88. Our great Father in heaven, thank you so much for this new week. Thank you for bringing us together today to worship you and to praise you and to learn about you, to increase our faith. We're so grateful for all the blessings we have. We're grateful for the rain that we've had this weekend. It's so good for our land, your land. Please be with us all and guide us. Today, uplift us and draw us close to you. Through your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Okay, well, let's have the announcements now by our brother Walt.
Good morning and welcome, brothers and sisters, young people of all ages, and friends to the Largo Tampa Bay Memorial Service. The Largo Tampa Bay Ecclesia meets on the basis of the Birmingham Amended Statement of Faith without reservation, and from the commandments of Christ concerning your own character. Commandment number 45, be watchful, diligent, brave, joyful, courteous, and manly. 1 Corinthians 6 and 13. And from commandment number 46, be sympathetic with others, both in their sorrows and their joys. Romans 12 and 5. The announcements and activities for today and upcoming events, Lord willing, are: today is June 7th, 2020. We have visitors and announcements. Brothers and sisters, if you have any thoughts concerning the status of our memorial service, please let an AB know. Your thoughts are important to us. And let us pray for all those who may be suffering because of physical or spiritual trials. Let us remember those our Lord blessed in the Sermon on the Mount. And let us pray for this ecclesia that it will always be a lampstand and a pathway for those who seek the kingdom of God. To preside today, our brother Chad Monahan. To exhort, brother Lou. Readers today is brother Gerardo Castellanos and brother Stephen Lewis. The electronic online service for June 14th will begin at 10:30 a.m. And to preside and exhort, our brother Chad Monahan. And now, brother Chad will give the classes and times for the upcoming events, Lord willing. Thank you.
Thanks, brother Walt. The schedule this week is every day, every morning, 7:30 a.m., children's prayer and praise, and then at 10 a.m., children's New Testament Bible stories. 2:30 p.m., children's Old Testament Bible stories. Monday through Friday at 10:40 a.m. is the sisters' meditation. Sundays, today at 3:30 p.m. is a hymn singing. And 7:30 p.m. is the children's Daniel Bible class. Tuesday evening, we have at 5:30 p.m. the children's Acts Bible class, and at 7 p.m. the Minor Prophets class. And we're getting into Habakkuk. Wednesday evening at 7:30 p.m. is the children's Daniel Bible class continued. So that's it. And if you'd like to be a part of any of that, please reach out to us and join us. It's really good. Okay, with the announcements now complete, it's time to hear from the Word of God. So first up, we have our second portion reading, which is going to be Isaiah 31, read to us by our brother Gerardo. Isaiah 31.
Isaiah chapter 31. All to them that go down to Egypt for help, and stay on horses, and trust in chariots, because they are many, and in horsemen, because they are very strong. But they look not unto the Holy One of Israel, neither seek the Lord. Yet he also is wise, and will bring evil, and will not call back his words, but will arise against the half of the evildoers and against the help of them that work iniquity. Now the Egyptians are men and not God, and their horses flesh and not spirit. When the Lord shall stretch out his hand, both he that helpeth shall fall, and he that is helped shall fall down, and they all shall fail together. For thus hath the Lord spoken unto me, like as the lion and the young lion roaring on his prey, when a multitude of shepherds is called forth against him, he will not be afraid of their voice, nor abase himself for the noise of them. So shall the Lord come down to fight for Mount Zion and for the hill thereof. As birds flying, so will the Lord of hosts defend Jerusalem. Defending also he will deliver it, and passing over he will preserve it. Turn ye unto him from whom the children of Israel have deeply revolted. For in the day every man shall cast away his idols of silver and his idols of gold, which your own hands have made unto you for a sin. Then shall the Assyrian fall with the sword, not of a mighty man, and the sword not of mean men shall devour him, but he shall flee from the sword, and his young men shall be discomfited, and he shall pass over to his stronghold for fear, and his princes shall be afraid of the ensign, saith the Lord, whose fire is in Zion, and his furnace in Jerusalem. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Gerardo. So let's turn over now to the third portion reading, which is James chapter 1. And to read that for us is our brother Stephen. James chapter 1.
The Epistle of James chapter 1. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. My brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into divers temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Let the brother of low degree rejoice in that he is exalted, but the rich in that he is made low, because as a flower of the grass he shall pass away. For the sun is no sooner risen with a burning heat, but it withereth the grass, and the flower thereof falleth, and the grace of the fashion of it perisheth. so also shall the rich man fade away in his ways. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Of his own will he begot us through the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creature. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholdeth himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty, and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. If any man among you seem to be religious, and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world.
Thanks, Brother Stephen. Well, let's set aside for a moment all the things and all the cares of this world, and let's give our attention to our brother Lou while he brings us words of exhortation.
Good morning, my beloved brethren and sisters. Today we will take a quick look at all three readings, beginning with our New Testament reading and ending with our New Testament reading. James opens his epistle with what we think is a rather strange thing to write. In the first verse of James 1, he sends greetings, which literally means I wish you joy. But then he continues in verse 2, stating, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. What does the apostle mean by this? We firstly need to understand that the word temptations would be better translated as trials or tests. But this still seems strange until we read the next verse, verse 3, which tells us that these trials are for our benefit, to build patience so that our characters may be perfected. This principle is illustrated by the readings for today as they describe the nations left in the land to test Israel and the time of Hezekiah as described by Isaiah the prophet. In this there is an exhortation for us as we remind ourselves of how to deal with trials in such a way to allow them to form our characters to fit us for God's kingdom. It was due to Israel's own failure that the trials or the testing came after they entered into the land of promise. Judges chapter 2 verses 1 to 3 show Israel how they were to deal with the nations who had inhabited the land previously. They were not to make any agreement with them at all. Particularly, They were to remove their religious practices and not be involved in them. However, the children of Israel decided not to do this. God was faithful to his side of the covenant because it was unbreakable, but the children of Israel didn't keep their side of the agreement. Therefore, they were to be a snare to them. The word snare literally means a trap, but it's clear from the context of Judges 3, verse 4, that this was to be a test. Yahweh was not trying to catch them out, but rather to test whether their reaction would be correct or not. As we see from Judges 3, verses 5 to 7, their reaction was not the correct one, especially as we see in verse 6. They intermarried, and they served their gods. Had they removed the false altars, then this would have not have been such a temptation for them. So they fell into a trap of their own making. And as Judges 2, verse 3 states, it was like thorns in their sides. There was a strong lesson here for us. We have also entered into a covenant relationship with the God of Israel. Luke 22, verse 20 shows the wine we are shortly to partake of teaches us this. The wine is the New Testament or covenant. We have also been commanded to maintain a separation from the things of this world. 1 Peter 2, verse 11 tells us that as strangers and pilgrims, we must abstain from those things that motivate the world in which we live. Particularly, we have been instructed to keep away from the religious practices of this world, whether they are those of false Christianity or any other system. 2 Corinthians 6, verses 15 to 17 makes this clear, showing the distinction between the true and false systems of worship, Christ and Belial, the temple of God and idols being contrasted, especially verse 17. It tells us to be ye separate. If we take this to ourselves, we must strive not to fall in the same way. Let us not leave the temptations in our lives to be a snare for us, as this could be a way in which we fall into diverse temptations through our own failure, as did Israel upon entering the land. All too often we do fall in this, though. We fall in this way as they did. And so the lesson for us is to learn from these trials and become wiser from our experience. Sometimes, though, it is not through our own failure that we are brought into trial. It is the Father's work in perfecting our characters. And this can be equally difficult to bear. In Isaiah 31, verse 1, against the background of the Assyrian invasion of Israel and Judah, we find the phrase in the first verse, "Woe to them that go down to Egypt for help." The chapter is speaking particularly of Judah, and we can see from the references to Zion and Jerusalem in verses 4 and 5. But there is no mention in the historical record of Hezekiah ever seeking help from Assyria at this time. Hosea certainly did, as we see in 2 Kings 17, verse 4. We have to understand, then, that the tribulation that Hezekiah felt when the Assyrian invasion led to the surrounding of Jerusalem, it was not a consequence of his own actions, but rather trials to build his character sent by God. We know from the record of other scriptures, for example, Isaiah 37 and Isaiah 38, that Hezekiah maintained his faithfulness under this great tribulation and turned to Yahweh in prayer for help. The result of Hezekiah's right response to this trial is also shown to us in Isaiah 31, verses 4 and 5, where God reassures him that his help will be provided in defending Jerusalem and preserving it, as we see in verse 5, by passing over. This phrase has the idea in the Hebrew of hovering over. Yahweh was there by his angelic ministers, hovering over the city to protect it from the surrounding Assyrian army. And we know from the king's record that the army of the Assyrians was miraculously destroyed. Here is a great example for us to follow. In 1 Peter 2, 19 and 20, we are told that we may have to endure suffering wrongly or falling into tribulation, which is not of our own making. In such circumstances, our reaction should also be to maintain our faith and turn to God in prayer for help. Our tribulations may not be as dramatic as those Hezekiah faced, but may well be equally difficult for us to face on a personal level. Our deliverance may not be as miraculous as the destruction of the Assyrian army, but as we are told in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13, God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that which ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. Hezekiah's response was to pray to God, and this is the advice of the apostle also. James 1 verse 5 says, we should ask for wisdom from God. In this context, the wisdom is to help us endure the trials so that our characters may be perfected, as verse 4 states, meaning matured, rounded, or complete, and has to do with learning from experience. As with Hezekiah, though, we must ask in faith, as verse 6 states, for we know that our Heavenly Father will never let us down. He is always consistent, as James 1:17 tells us. There is an attitude which we must avoid, but which we all too often do not. This is identified in James 1, verse 13, and it is the attitude of blaming God for our failures. But we must recognize that God doesn't tempt us. Temptations arise from within, as verses 14 and 15 clearly shows. God is testing our faith so as to make us fit for his kingdom. We see similar words in 1 Peter 1, 6 and 7, where Peter shows us that this may bring us sadness and distress at times, but that it is for our ultimate good, that our faith may become more precious than anything the world values. The similarity between Peter's words and those of James centers on the idea of rejoicing, and Peter makes it clear that this is to do with the future glory, which is our hope when the Lord Jesus Christ returns. So, it is this looking forward to the kingdom which is the basis of our rejoicing, our counting it all joy, for he who endures tribulation will be granted an entrance into that kingdom. As we now focus on these emblems and the great example of our Master, we think of what great tribulations he endured so that we with him might be delivered from the consequences of sin. In our readings Friday, Hebrews 12 verses 2 and 3, we are told that Jesus endured such contradiction of sinners, the agony and the shame of the crucifixion being the greatest tribulation, for the joy that was set before him. Let us now, brethren and sisters, as we eat this bread representing our Lord's body and drink this wine, a symbol of our Master's blood, let us determine to do the same as our Savior, endure all that is presented before us as we await the joy that is to come. Be strong and be safe, my dear brethren and sisters.
Thank you, Brother Lou. Well, before we share in this memorial, let us join together in singing this hymn. We're going to sing hymn 229. Hymn 229, Father of Lights, all blessings flow from thee. Hear while we pray in Jesus' name and in humility. Hymn 229. Well, as Brother Lou took us through the readings today, he reminded us about the covenant relationship that we have with our Lord Jesus Christ and to what extent he went for us. While sharing this meal, we can see how these emblems are the results of his work in us. So let's keep the cares of the world away for another moment and meditate on the life of Jesus Christ. He brought the Word of God to life. He embodies all the elements of God's love for us. Bread is a symbol of the fruit of that work he is doing, and he's sharing it with us. We too can bring the Word of God to life by doing our part in this covenant we have with our Father in heaven and with his Son. Jesus shared this meal with the disciples, just as he is sharing it today with us. Paul reminds us that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." We'll now have our brother Troy offer thanks for this bread.
Our loving and merciful Father in heaven, the Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, our Father and our God. Heavenly Father, we come unto you at this time to thank you so much for last night's rest, and we pray that tonight's rest will be just as good. We pray for the forgiveness of our sins and pray for the forgiveness of the sins of others. We pray, Father, that through your mercy, grace, and forgiveness, we'll be allowed in your kingdom with our loved ones today, who are alive today. We also pray, Father, that through your mercy, grace, and forgiveness, we'll be allowed to live forever with GMO in the kingdom. And we pray, Father, at this time for the bread that we're about to eat. We pray that it would strengthen us and guide us and keep us in the way that we need to go when we come to stand before your Son in the kingdom. We pray for your mercy and grace, Father, and your forgiveness. Help us to forgive the sins of others. We pray, Father, this and all things, and in through the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
Just as Jesus lived a life manifesting his Father, he also took his flesh to the grave along with everything it has to offer, all its distractions and opportunities. He drowned it in the Jordan River, just as we have, and ultimately he hung it on the cross. The life in his spilled blood would go on to feed us to a new eternal life. Paul continues in this letter to the Corinthians. He says, after the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. We'll now have a prayer of thanks for this cup by our brother Walt.
Most merciful and loving God, once again, dear Father, we bow our heads and continue in prayer, now giving thanks for this wine which we're about to partake of, the wine that symbolizes the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son, who gave his life on the cross as that perfect sacrifice so that we may find life eternal in your kingdom. We pray, Father, that all we do here today is pleasing to thee and thy Son, and we give thanks for all thy blessings. In Jesus Christ's name we give thanks. Amen.
Well, this concludes our service this week. Thank you again for joining us. Thank you for continuing to support and be a part of this ecclesia in these times. We're going to close our service this week by singing together a hymn, and afterwards we'll have our closing prayer. We're going to finish off today by singing hymn 426. We plow the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. Hymn 426.
Thank you.
Great Father in heaven, we come again to you thankful for this ecclesia, and thank you for your word and for your son, and this time that we've had to put it all together and to take a moment out of our week and be together to love and worship you. Please continue to strengthen us. Please return your son Jesus soon. We're so thankful for the hope that you give us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.